Hey everybody, in this video what I'd like to do is do a full test on a new compression driver that I just purchased. It's the RCF ND840, and so this is a large format compression driver. It features a 3-inch diaphragm with a 1.4 inch throat. So I've had good luck with these RCF new series of ND compression drivers. I really like the ND350, which I featured in my previous video. So you can see the size difference, 1.7 inch diameter voice coil and 3-inch diameter voice coil. I had the ND650 mounted to this horn, and this horn is a 600 Hertz biradial. It's called the ES600. And so 600 Hertz low frequency cutoff. And so this is the original prototype. And so I use it for testing. I have a pair built. And so the ND650, which has a 2.5 inch diameter voice coil, I found that it really kind of struggled to get down to 600 Hertz with some mid-range authority. So I found that it just kind of struggled to get down that low. 600 Hertz is quite low for that size of a compression driver. And so I was really curious with the 3-inch. Now I've had customers go with the 4-inch, which is the ND940, and it sounds fantastic. So I thought, well, let's try the 3-inch. And so let's get started. I'm gonna do a full set of tests on this baby. And so I'm gonna just set it up out of the way. You've seen the horn. So so the first set of measurements that I did was the raw frequency response, and so you can see it there. It has a relatively flat frequency response. It has a little bit of a mid-range hump, but that's nothing that can't be dealt with in the crossover. And so moving on to the distortion sweep, you can see there it has very low distortion through from 500 Hertz around up to around 5 kilohertz, where it just starts to rise a little bit, and it's around 0.2% on the second harmonic, but the third and the fourth harmonic actually remains quite low at around 0.1%. So moving on to the burst decay, you'll see that the burst decay is actually incredibly clean through from 500 Hertz up to 10 kilohertz. And so and then when we see past 10 kilohertz, we're going to see some breakup. I'm not sure what would be causing this specifically, but I can only assume that it would be some form of breakup or some sort of a resonance there that you can see. So moving to the colored polar map. Now, I did off-axis measurements on this, even though I have featured the ES600 before in previous blog posts, not in other videos, but in my blog. This compression driver, it's a unique design because the phase plug is right up against the bug screen on the, so if you look at this, you have the bug screen. These RCF compression drivers, the fins there that you see inside, that's the end of the phase plug. It's right very close to the bug screen. So I've found, if you notice in my previous video, that the off-axis does actually change with the type of physical transition in the throat of the horn. So we've seen better off-axis above 10K with this particular driver, because I feel like that the contributor there was that the phase plug was so close to the actual throat of the horn. So you can see there, we get excellent off-axis polars. So for a 600 Hertz horn, it's virtually unheard of to get excellent off-axis up to 20K on a 600 Hertz horn. So you can see there's a nice, even, well-behaved off-axis that gradually narrows, and yet still at even 20 kilohertz, we're still getting 80 degrees coverage window, which is better than most 1-inch dome tweeters. So really happy with that result with the combination of the ES600 and the ND840. So my subjective listening impressions on this. So what I found was that Mid-range is very transparent, very open. However, I was detecting a bit of harshness at around 10K and up. And so when you see that there's some issues there with the burst decay. Now, I did in my previous video use this combination with the super tweeter 5K and up. And that's what I was referring to, and has very clear mid-range. You can use this as a mid-range only horn. However, the off-axis is good enough that you can use it in a two-way application, assuming that the compression driver is able to play up to, you know, 20 kilohertz. So what I felt that I should do, and you'll know from my previous videos or tests and different blogs, that I like to modify the compression drivers. And so what I did in this particular case is I removed the back plate, and you can see there the 3-inch titanium diaphragm, and I installed a little piece of 30 ppi, which is parts per inch, open cell foam into the rear chamber. And so I just set it on top of the dome and then put the cover back on and secured the cover, and it just gently presses on the very tip of the dome, so that if we're finding that that's where the resonance is coming from, if there's breakup in the very tip of that diaphragm at the top of the dome, then that foam will act to damp that resonance. And so what we see here is we have the before and the burst decay before the foam, okay? And then I tested it after I installed the foam. And so you can see that the burst decay is actually significantly improved, but not where I necessarily thought it would. So 10K still has a little bit of stored energy, a little bit of resonance, but above 15K, we see a dramatic improvement with the results. And so looking at the frequency response chart, you can see that there really is no difference with the frequency response between having the foam and no foam in the rear chamber. So really the net benefit is there. So there's no drawbacks that I could detect. And I also compared the step response as well, and I didn't see any difference with the step response either. I looked at the distortion sweep as well, and because my microphone only goes to 20 kilohertz, I wasn't able to get any kind of distortion sweep in the region of interest, which would have been 10 kilohertz up to 20 kilohertz. Okay, so now I set it all back up and then listened to the compression driver in a two-way setup, and I was actually very, very happy with what I was hearing, especially in the upper treble. It seemed to really, a little tiny piece of foam transformed the upper treble into something that was very pleasant, very smooth. And so the benefit of having the two-way is that you have that point source sound from 600 hertz all the way up to 20 kilohertz. So you have that very coherent sound, especially through the vocals, listening to acoustic guitar. I was just listening to Ray LaMontagne live, and his guitar, I mean, you can sense every little subtle harmonic through his guitar, you know, because the acoustic guitar, it's covering low mid-range, and then the strings is going to be the upper treble. And so everything was just so tied together that it just sounded beautiful. It was spine tingling. So there you have it. ES600 with the ND840. So excellent compression driver. They're not cheap. They're fairly expensive compression driver, but I really feel like you do get what you pay for with these drivers. There's a lot of technology packed into them. So, I mean, I don't have a commercial interest in these drivers. I don't sell them. They're a little bit hard to get in Canada, but I just really like them. And so the idea with a brand is that it's commercially available to the average DIY enthusiast. So that's important to me. Like, I'm not going to push a brand that's no longer available, such as, Fostex, for example, last year stopped producing their compression drivers. So they really appealed to me because they had the Elnico magnets, and they had a reputation, and they looked nice, right? And they're meant for more recording studio monitor applications, not necessarily pro sound. And so I was looking at using those, but I found, I think with the RCF compression drivers, you really do get the sound quality there for audiophile applications. My friend is telling me I should try the 18 sound compression drivers, since they use, you know, a special doping on the diaphragm, which really stiffens up the diaphragm. They said it's twice as stiff as titanium. Titanium's not that stiff, but anyways, something that I might consider in the future is looking at that. So that's it for now. If you have any questions, leave a comment. If you like this video, click like and subscribe to my channel. Have a great day.